In step 7, we're going to realize the inverters. We finished step 6 with this prototype. We have a prototype which consists of 3 hybrid resonators, and pairs of resonators are separated by an inverter. It is those inverters that we want to realize. Now, when we realize these inverters using stubs, we will find that there are stubs that are in parallel. And so we will need to combine those adjacent stubs. The result of this step is shown here. It is a prototype without inverters and only consists of stubs. And as we will see, those pi arrangements of stubs can be realized by a combline section. So let's review the realization of an impedance inverter using stubs. The exact realization is this pi arrangement of impedances. And these are frequency-independent impedances. We know of nothing that can realize these frequency-independent reactance values. If we used lumped inductors or lumped capacitors, they will have a strong frequency dependence, linear in the case of an inductor, or inversely proportional to frequency in the case of a capacitor. We demonstrate that these two ports are identical by using ABCD parameters. And we see that that is a broadband match. Now, we can realize these impedances using stubs, as shown here. The first impedance has a value of minus J56.9 ohms, so it's a capacitor. We will realize that with a short length of open-circuited stub. The series impedance is an inductance, J56.9 ohms, so we will realize that with a short length of shorted stub. Now, it turns out that this is better than using a lumped element to implement these impedance values, because the derivative of the impedance looking into these stubs, provided that they're lambda on 8 long, that is 1/8 of a wavelength long, is fairly low. So the stubs are a good realization. It'll have a bandwidth of maybe 5 or 10%. Here is our prototype at the end of step 6. We can realize that first inverter by using that pi arrangement of stubs. Now, of course, we already have a stub there. So the stub Z01 and the stub with the characteristic impedance of 56.9 ohms are in parallel. And we will need to combine these stubs. So an interesting thing is that these stubs are different. This stub has an inductive input impedance, and the second stub has a capacitive input impedance. One is a short-circuited stub, and one is an open-circuited stub. But we can still combine. Here are the two stubs again, just highlighted and brought out of the circuit. Now, to go through the process of combining the stubs, we convert these stubs to impedances. So we have a positive reactance in parallel with a negative reactance. We can combine those impedances. We add their admittances together. So we convert the parallel stubs into a single impedance, and then we convert back to stub form. Now, we actually could have done this by just dealing with the transmission line equations for the input impedance, and we get exactly the same result. It is a little bit easy to see how we do this with lumped elements. So going back to the full filter now, this is the current prototype for our filter. And the important thing here is that there are no inverters. All that we see are stubs. A few characteristics of this. FR is equal to 2F0. That is our design criteria. That is, the resonant frequency of the stubs in our design are equal to 2F0. And F0 is the center frequency of the design. And as I've said before, nearly every design we're going to do has FR equal to 2F0. And that's primarily because when we realize an impedance using a stub that is 1/8 of a wavelength long, we have a fairly low derivative of that impedance value with respect to frequency. So that is the most common choice. But it is not the only possible choice. And so I'm telling you that you really need to be explicit in your designs as to what your choice is, and not just to assume it. I've read many papers where the author simply doesn't say what their assumption is, and you start off with the paper assuming that FR is equal to 2F0, but you're never really quite clear until you reverse engineer the paper. But that is a bit of a waste of time. Just think of somebody checking your designs or reverse engineering your designs. If they had to assume something up front, well, it's not clear that your design is complete. So let's see how close our prototype is to the final form that we want. Here is our comb line section. This is the model we're using for the comb line section. Here is the current prototype for our filter. You see here a pie arrangement of shorted stubs. And if you look at our prototype, you can see two pie arrangements of shorted stubs. So we pull out the first pie, and we clearly see the pie arrangement. We can see that we can realize that pie arrangement of shorted stubs by a comb line section. And if we pull out the second pie arrangement, we see another pie arrangement of shorted stubs that can be realized by a comb line section. Now, one of the things here is that we've actually shared the central shorted shunt stub. So have we made an error, or what is the problem here? Well, in fact, there isn't a problem. We're going to realize the left pie arrangement of stubs using a comb line section. We're going to realize the right pie arrangement of stubs by using another pair of coupled lines, but we're going to share that central line between the two pairs. So we haven't introduced a problem here. We can repeat that central line because we're going to share that central line. Have we made a small error? Most likely, but it's probably in the range of 1%, 2%, or 3%. Now, if we add in our capacitors, this is the form of the parallel coupled line filter that we're going to end up with. Now, there is an issue with resonant frequency, and we need to address that here. With the comb line section, we used a model which consisted of a pie arrangement of shorted stubs. And with this model, FR was equal to F0. That was our assumption when this was developed, where here F0 is the center frequency of the match. Now, in our design, those stubs are going to be 1/8 of a wavelength long. And so our operating frequency, that is the F0 for our filter, which is distinct from the F0 for this match here, the F0 of our filter is going to be a half of FR. So there's a little issue going on here. So let's look at our filter. With our filter, FR is equal to 2F0, which is telling us that the stubs are 1/8 of a wavelength long. So the F0s are different here. In one case, F0 is the center of the bandpass filter. In the other case, F0 is the center of the match for the parallel coupled line model. To answer this, we need to re-examine the development that led to the assignment of FR. Let's consider this circuit here. This is the exact model for the comb line section shown in the top left there. So this comes directly from the equations describing the transmission line properties of the line. We see here that we have a transmission line on the top here, which has an even mode characteristic impedance. The second line has an odd mode characteristic impedance, and the transformers shown here combine the characteristics of those lines such that we end up with the right characteristics, that is, the right transmission line equations for our parallel coupled lines. So there is nothing here that depends on the relationship of FR and F0. This is a broadband match. And if we wanted to simulate a pair of coupled lines in a simulator, this is the circuit that we can use. And there are similar circuits to this when we have many lines that are in parallel, and we have a direct model. So again, this is exactly the same model that we just talked about. This is the exact model. However, we used an approximate model in developing that simple form of model for a comb line section. The circuit shown at the bottom here is the approximate model for a pair of coupled lines, not just for a comb line section. Now, this approximate model helps us in developing our prototype circuit. The exact model is just a little bit too complex. No one's been able to figure out how to come up with a prototype synthesis procedure which leads to the form of that exact model. But for the approximate model, we have a prototype synthesis process which leads to a circuit which can directly be translated into PCL filter form. So this is an approximate model. It is believed to be most accurate when FR is equal to F0, that is most accurate under all conditions, and that is when the lines are lambda on 4 long at the operating frequency, but it is a reasonably good model at all frequencies, even when it is lambda on 8 long. And besides that, we don't have any choice, we have to use this model. Are we introducing some errors here? Yes, of course we are. Those errors are probably in that 1, 2, 3% range, maybe in some extreme cases it could be about 5%. So this approximate model doesn't depend on that relationship of FR equal to F0. That happens to be when the model is the most accurate, but it is pretty good at other frequencies. Now in the end, we can live with these approximations because we're going to do a detailed EM simulation of our filter, and we will be able to look at the effect of all of our approximations. And we know that this approximation is minor because when we do a detailed EM simulation, everything seems to come out pretty well. So let's consider how we came up with our simplified model. So we have a pair of coupled lines here in our comb line section. We have a short circuit at two ports, 3 and 4, and so we implement those short circuits in our approximate model. That reduces to that form. That reduces to a form where the stubs are shown explicitly, and we can use a transformation which converts that transformer and series stub into a shunt stub and series stub as shown on the bottom there. And that is the model that we're using in trying to show that our prototype filter matches a pair of coupled lines in a comb line configuration. That model has that small error of 2 or 3 or 4%, so that we can use that model with those lines lambda on 8 long. So this model here does not depend on the relationship of FR and F0. So let's revisit the relationship between our prototype and our parallel coupled line configuration. We saw this slide before, so I'm just showing this again. We look at the first pi arrangement that's looped here in red, and we see that we have this pi arrangement of shorted stubs, and that is exactly the approximate model of our comb line section. We can pull out the rightmost pi arrangement of stubs, which is shown here, and that'll give us another pair. But we shared a stub between the two networks, and that happens to be this shared center line here. So it is legitimate for us to share that stub between the two pi arrangements, because when we come up with our comb line layout, we in fact share a line. So in the end, with step 7, we have this arrangement of stubs. The main thing we've done is that we have removed the inverters that were in the previous step. So that's a pretty good design. It's in a 50 ohm system. This will be a bandpass filter. There are two related problems with this design, and that is that the characteristic impedances of our shunt stubs are too low. So if we look at Z01, it has a characteristic impedance of 8.7 ohms. Z02 has a characteristic impedance of 10.27 ohms. Those characteristic impedances are too low. We would really like our microstrip lines not to have a characteristic impedance of less than, say, around about 30 ohms. So we have to do something here.